The name Tight Bond is well known in the woodworking community for their wood glues, but did you know that they have other impressive product lines? Tight Bond's construction adhesives and Cochise sealants are made with a professional in mind. Builders and contractors depend on Tight Bond to deliver the most consistent and high-performing construction adhesives for their projects, including the industry's number one FRP adhesive. Tight Bond's line of Cochise sealants ensure unbeatable adhesion for a wide variety of applications and weather conditions, with the most comprehensive color matching program in the industry. To see Tight Bond's complete variety of products, visit their website at tightbond.com. The worst home failures I've read about in my career involve wood fiber sheathing. It was this development that Martin Holliday wrote, and these brick-clad homes had this wood fiber sheathing, and as y'all know, it's super vapor open. It's so badly that water would run out the bottom because of the poly that was on the interior. So, welcome to the Fine Homebuilding Podcast, our weekly discussion of building, remodeling, and design topics aimed at anybody who cares deeply about the craft and science of working on houses. I'm Senior Editor Patrick McComb. Today I'm joined by Fine Homebuilding Editorial Advisor Mike Girton.
Hello.
Fine Homebuilding Senior Editor Brian Pontalillo.
Hey, everyone.
And our amazing producer, Andres Samaniego. You can find previous podcasts and check out the show notes at finehomebuilding.com/podcast. Please email your questions, feedback, and concerns to FHBpodcast@taunton.com. I said concerns there. Like, I hope no one has concerns at this point in the show, but who knows? It's good to see you guys.
Yeah.
Good to see you, too.
Good to see you.
Boy, Mike, you've been busy around your place, and I'm reminded when I see your photography how absolutely beautiful it is in your part of Arizona. Do you want to tell folks what you've been doing?
You know, I haven't been on in a couple weeks, and since I'm not doing any work except on my houses, as opposed to you guys at, you know, pretty much evenings and weekends, I have a full-time job just working around here, so I'm always getting something done. My big project for the latter half of the winter has been doing a patio in the backyard where I had that mini excavator, so I pretty much wrapped that up, built a berm wall that I put some riprap rock along to keep the dirt from cascading down against the house, which it had been doing for years, and then put a patio down, just a paver patio. I kept discussing with my wife, okay, so how big do we want this? She said, oh, go the whole back of the house. I go, that's like 80 feet long. You're only going to put, you know, like 3 or 4 chairs out there at any one time. So luckily we scaled it back by about 50%. So now it's only about 40 feet.
It looks amazing.
And then yeah, it looks good. Yeah, it came out good. Yeah.
What advice would you give someone who's tackling a project like that?
Prep the base. That's, you know, putting the pavers down is the easy part, but you've got to, you know, compact the original earth, grade it, you know, get a pretty good grade on it so it's sloping the direction you want. So water doesn't, you don't have any standing water. And then put down the base material that you can, fine tune the grading, and then whatever you're going to set the pavers on. In this case, there's a bedding sand that's locally sold at the aggregate store shop yard, and I have them deliver, you know, like 5 tons of that, and then spread that down and then screeded it off, and I just use some electrical conduit, some 3/4, 1 inch, 1 inch electrical conduit as my screeds, and just set those down on my base, and then just pulled a straight edge along it and got a really nice even flat surface, so I just dropped the pavers in. That was the quickest part of the whole project.
Do you have to compact it with mechanical equipment, Mike, or how do you make sure the ground is sufficiently compacted for this?
Well, I don't have to worry here because the caliche natural soil, I scraped it off, and it is like concrete. So it was, I didn't have to worry about it. Ordinarily, if I was back in Rhode Island, my sub-base, the native soil, I would have to run a compactor on that because it's uneven in its compressive strength, and that before I set the base down, base material, like a gravel. You know,
Well, I'm sure folks who are considering this will value your expertise, so thanks for sharing that. And then you sent me a photo of, it looks like an outbuilding with a screw-down metal roof on it.
Yep. So that last year, I think I talked about it one of the podcasts. There was a horse barn, a five-stall horse barn, and I don't have horses, so I turned it into a garage for my pickup camper. And it had a galvanized sheet metal roof that Addison and I worked on and tuned up. And it would get so hot in there when the sun would beat on it. Even if it's only 60 or 65 degrees outside, the temperature in there would be 85 or 90 by, 4 o'clock in the afternoon on a sunny day, which we get a lot of. And you can imagine in the summer when it's 105 outside, it could be probably 120 inside there. And I wanted to keep it cooler. And I researched, what can you do to paint an old galvanized metal roof? And I went to both Sherwin-Williams and Ben Moore websites, figuring they're reputable, conscientious manufacturers of paint products. And they basically said, wash the surface and then put a good quality latex paint on it. So I just got your basic, I got a higher grade of, each company has, three or four levels of grades of paint. So I got a next to the top level of paint, white, just the off the shelf white, painted it on with a roller, and the temperature inside is not but 5 degrees warmer than outside. It was just so dramatic for the past week walking in and out. So reflective roofs work.
That's really cool.
Until you experience it, you really don't realize what a difference when you're in a climate that is, a cooling climate, the difference that a white roof could make. So all those folks I see who are putting dark roofs in, Texas and Florida, who put a dark shingle roof or a dark tile roof, I got to wonder if they're doing themselves a disservice by doing so. It'd be better off with a white tile roof or a white metal roof instead.
Yeah, there's been a lot of research on this topic, right? I don't think it needs to be proven. I mean, even I remember Fernando wrote an article for GBA a few years ago on walls, and it works the same way on walls. White light color walls can help keep a building cool.
That's why in the Mediterranean, the traditional architecture has white stucco, right?
White walls. Good point, yeah.
Fascinating stuff. And it delights me that it's such a simple fix. Mike, I think, you may have a few hundred bucks in paint, but geez, that seems like a huge help.
Yeah.
And it's going to make your camper last longer, is my guess.
Yeah, I figure everything inside there. Mm-hmm. And then one last thing, something I didn't do myself, because I thought about it. I had accumulated a massive pile of brush, limbing trees, and a massive pile of broken up concrete and bricks from around the yard of things I dismantled. And so I looked at the cost of getting containers, dumpsters. I figured it would take 3 30-yard dumpsters at about $600 a piece. And then I started searching, what if I found somebody just to do hauling? And I went on Craigslist and I found a guy, and he came in, and for half of what it would have cost me in dumpsters, he hauled it all away in a dump trailer. And it took him about maybe 2 half days for him. And for him, it's money in his pocket, because it was labor that I would have had to do anyway. And he's hauling it with his own equipment. So, he's already has that overhead cost in truck and dump trailer already invested. So I was glad to, pay him. Plus I gave him a big tip at the end, because he really worked hard doing it. But boy, sometimes I never think about it when you're building a house. A lot of contractors get dumpsters. It might be more economical to just make a corral and throw all the junk in there and then hire somebody like this who just hauls trash away to haul it away towards, or periodically during the construction process.
I think
I've heard from remodelers who are my friends who they say that a dump trailer like that quickly pays for itself in dumpster fees, and you know it's a value added service because you can better control you know the site and the damage that can occur from a giant dumpster on a property, mm-hmm. right? It's some heavy.
It keeps all the neighbors from loading it up.
Right. Brian, what have you been working on?
Not much. I had two mystery issues in around the house this week. An electrical issue in my truck, Patrick, which you and I talked about quite a bit, like a battery that just keeps I keep coming out to a dead battery, and obviously not every time, or I would, you know, I would be more alarmed about this. Like I came out to a dead battery one morning, jumped the truck. But everything was, I thought I might've left something on. I didn't know what could have happened, but I just jumped the truck and it was, you know, it was fine for a few days. So I just kept driving. And then, you know, again, I come out to a dead battery, jump the truck again. Now I'm thinking, okay, I'm going to have to look into this, but it drove for the next few days. And then yesterday I came out to, 2 days ago, came out to a dead battery again. And so there was just enough corrosion on the cables and terminals that I decided to start with just cleaning those. And even the guys at the auto parts store said, you know, even before you spend money on a battery, just take those off, really scrub them, clean them really well, and see if that solves it. So I'm right where I was yesterday, where it's starting right now, but we'll, you know, I won't know if it worked for a couple of days. So that's one thing. And then I had some water come out from under my dishwasher last week. And I inspected...
That'll keep you up at night.
Yeah, it happened once. And I inspected everything and couldn't find a leak. And, but I didn't want to, you know, I didn't want to run the dishwasher again and have a bigger problem. So I've been trying to figure out what's going on. I did clean the filter out and it was quite dirty, so I'm quite junked up. So I don't know if maybe the water wasn't draining fast enough and backed up in the machine. If maybe it leaked out through the door, because I didn't see it happening. I never saw where it was coming from. But it's a mystery. I'm going to run the dishwasher today and just kind of watch and see what happens. But I can't find any signs of a leak anywhere.
Oh, that's no smoking gun is terrible, right?
Yeah.
With a number of rental houses over the years with dishwashers, I regularly ran into that issue with them. A tenant would call me up and say, oh, there's a big puddle of water in front of or under the dishwasher. And then I started investigating, and I found it to be particularly a problem on some of the dishwashers. The way the gasketing works, at the lower left and the lower right corners, there are these little plastic deflectors that if water gets behind the deflector, it'll drain out through the hinge at the bottom. And what was causing those deflectors to not deflect the water back into the tub was one of two things. One, the deflector got pinched the wrong way, so it wasn't really deflecting the water anymore. And or when they would load the dishwasher, there would be a dish which would be leaned towards the door where the water spray would hit that and then jettison the water towards the door at that corner. So we could replicate it by putting a dish in and just running an empty cycle to see what would happen, and I could reproduce that effect. So it was a combination of figuring out if that was a problem. So it's something that that would be my first thing is check to see where there might be something with either the deflector, if you have them on that model, or the gasket itself.
Yeah.
Because otherwise, if it was a leaking problem from one of your pipes underneath, it would be constant rather than related to operating the washer.
Right. Yeah. So both of those things are, you know, I told Patrick the other day, Patrick suggested for my truck that I go on YouTube, and I said, no, You know, because I'll spend the whole day on, I won't work, I'll spend the whole day on YouTube, you know, trying to fix my truck. So I've resisted that temptation and suggestion so far, but the weekend's coming, so we'll see what happens.
Yeah, you're going to want to dig into parasitic draw and buy yourself a test light, and you're going to be checking individual circuits. Oh, it's awesome. You're going to love it.
When you drive, Brian, with your truck, do you drive a lot of short trips, or do you drive longer trips?
No, everything's short. I just, you know, I work at home, and I drive. So I drive my truck just around town, and that's it.
So what I found, my mother has the same problem, is that the amps, well, I don't know, is it, no, not amps, it's watts. The watts that it takes out of your battery when you start it. So say you drive from your house and you go 5 miles to the store, and then you turn it off and you start it again and you drive home. You're depleting the battery quite a bit to start it sometimes. Uh-huh. And there's not enough driving time for the alternator to charge the battery back up. So that sometimes your battery is slowly getting depleted, and it's not getting a good full charge. So that could be also related, especially if a battery is starting to wane mm-hmm. in its age, and the terminals, as the two of you were thinking, because those terminals would reduce the amount of electricity going back into the battery from the charging circuit. Or it could also be the waning of an alternator too,
right,
as it's on its way out. So there's so many little things that could be a combination.
You're going to want to dig into that weekend, this weekend, and when you decide you are going to sell it, just let me know, and I'll give me a call. Andres and I were on a video shoot yesterday, which was a pretty fun time. We were back up at HVP's new headquarters in Kent, Connecticut, to document some of the air sealing measures they've taken to improve the envelope of this house, which our best guess was built around 1910, 1920, and what was cool about this project from a fine home building content perspective to me is that this house is like so many millions of other homes out in the country and in Canada. And, you know, so they took what I would describe as pretty reasonable measures to improve this house, including insulating the band joist. Perhaps the most interesting thing they did, or unconventional thing they did, was to use aero barrier to try and seal up the tiny holes in this house. And they almost cut the air leakage in half. They went from, 13 air changes an hour down to 7. And I think that is a phenomenal improvement for, you know, a reasonable sum. So you guys will want to follow that.
So were you videotaping the aero seal process, or was it just a blower door process?
It was a blower door process, Mike. And then we, Andres took a camera around the building with Mason, Lord, and myself, and we looked at the improvements that were made. And I think the point we were trying to get across was that this is something that ordinary folk could do and should not be intimidated by. And I think it would pay for itself pretty quickly when you're talking about such a significant reduction in leakage. And I think Mason was a little disappointed that the number wasn't lower, but I mean, aside from taking down all the plaster or pulling all the siding off, I don't see how you could do better, really.
Is there insulation in the exterior walls?
No, and that was a conscious choice to maintain the vapor profile of this old house. Don't want to start messing things up and have materials start degrading because they're getting wet seasonally. Mm-hmm. So they also rehabbed all the double hung windows with new weather stripping, and they left the wavy glass and historic trim, and the house looks like nothing really happened to it. Except you have to go down in the basement and see that they put some rigid insulation along the band joist and spray foam. And otherwise, it's very hard to tell. What do you think, Andres?
Yeah, it looked great. Looked moving ready, so they said. I think the front door needed some gaskets. And I think that would have helped a little bit, you know, with that 7 number that we got. Because I could definitely feel some draft. Other than that, the lower window where they had to do some epoxy to replace the hole or patch the hole, that also, you know, you could feel some a little bit of draft. Other than that, I think, you know, that was pretty much what you could do.
What occurred to me going home was something I thought about my own house. And, you know, this thing has an oil burner, forced air furnace, right? And a giant flue. You know, what the heck do you, like, how do you improve that? Mike, you're nodding. What do you think about that?
Yeah, the old, is it a natural draft?
Yeah.
Unit? Yeah. Yeah, so those, there's nothing you can do with that pipe, because even when it's not operating, there's air leaking around the barometric damper, and it's just stack effect right out through the roof.
And it's huge. It's a huge hole.
Yep.
Yeah, I think...
just like a fireplace, you know.
We'll probably talk about this question on the podcast in the next coming weeks, but we got a great letter from a listener this week that, you know, she described all this air sealing work they're doing and, you know, tightening the house, trying to get it down close to, you know, one air change per hour. And, you know, and then she talked about wanting to burn wood in her big central, you know, fireplace. And it was just like... It's unfortunate, because I get it. We all love that, you know, the ambiance of a fireplace, but it unfortunately it just does not jibe with all that work to air seal and try to make your house efficient and comfortable.
Put it on a three season porch or put it outside is what I say, and you can still enjoy it. And when the weather is cold,
yeah.
Once again, we heard from our amazing listeners, and thank you all for writing in with your comments and questions. I really, really appreciate it. It makes the show amazing. This comes from John, who's in Cazenovia, New York, which is near Syracuse, also near Chittenango, and our podcast friend, Adam. Adam, if you're listening, we haven't heard from you in a while. Hope you're well. John writes, "Hey, podcast crew, I'm writing to update... with an update to a question I asked in episode 614 about my coworker's extremely high water bill. After much pushback from the utility, persistence has finally paid off. They finally sent someone out to replace the meter, and the new bill showed 6,000 gallons used in that quarter, which included some time in the old meter and some on the new. Thanks for all your suggestions. Patrick, you mentioned recently you installed some low voltage landscape lighting. This is a goal I have for this spring. I have 75 feet of walkway, which I want to outfit with path lights, and I would like to add 3 or 4 lights to highlight some of the trees in the landscape. There's recently been discussion on the LED under cabinet and closet lights and how terrible the included connectors are. Could you provide listeners with some words of wisdom or recommendation for things to do and not to do, specifically to the low voltage landscape lights? There are kits available at the box store at a fraction of the cost of the kits I see at some electrical supply websites. Should we stay away from these things at the box store? I'm located near Syracuse, New York, so we get freeze, thaw, and snow and ice to deal with, and I don't want to find myself replacing a faulty product within the next few years. Thanks for the input, John." Well, John, I can't speak to the long-term durability of my landscape lights, but I did opt for the home center variety because they are far less expensive than the other versions you mentioned. I'll let you know how they do. I did find that... the connectors that connect the individual fixtures to the, I don't know what you call them, like power lines, low voltage lines where they grab power. Some connectors have this big plastic knob, and while it's clunky looking and hard to hide, I find it's very reliable. The other cheaper ones I saw had wire nuts, and I was not convinced that water was going to stay out of those, and I imagine they would corrode pretty quickly and degrade the connection, so... I'll let you know my experience. If other folks who have done this work, I would much rather share your input with your greater experience and perhaps longer-term test. Thoughts, Mike?
No, I haven't ever installed them myself, so I don't know.
Brian, have you ever done this kind of work?
Never done any low-voltage lighting work.
Andres, any of your property? Yeah, your way. Okay, lay it on me.
Yeah, I did. I did last summer. I did. I got a kit from Zumbi, I think the company was, off of Amazon. I think it was like $120, something like that. It came in a 12 pack, and they are the nuts are weather sealed, so you have to like tighten it, like connect both, tighten it. But I also put, you know, electrical tape on that. But I connect that to the low voltage transformer, and I got a brand new breaker line, and ran it outside to my. To my exterior, and now I need to air seal that penetration, as I said last time.
Well, we'll be checking in on the air sealing effort on that, because we all know that's going to be what listeners are most interested in. Yeah, so yours hasn't been installed all that long either. So maybe folks out there who have longer term installations can write in with what has worked for them or not. And this comes from Dave. Dave is our friend in Vermont who runs a small contracting business. Hi, Patrick and crew. I've been working on the shop in a small building cabinet for a client, and my Bluetooth-enabled hearing protection has gotten me pretty well caught up on the back episodes of the podcast. I have some feedback for way back in episode 598. There was a fellow, Seth, who was trying to troubleshoot his straw-bale house. I wrote in years ago about a failing straw-bale home I was working on, and wow, did I learn a lot through that process. I forgot which episode you all answered it on, though. It was before COVID, and I got a sticker for the question. If I recall correctly, y'all's advice was similar to 598's. You didn't know a whole lot about straw bale construction, and, well, good luck. Which kind of sounds like what we would say. I made many friends as I researched how to best repair and hopefully solve the underlying issues with this house. It was an early 2000s iteration of a straw bale home, and so was relying heavily on info that was well-informed, but which misunderstood stucco as an exterior cladding. The California Straw Bale Building Association was extremely helpful to me. One of their folks set up a phone call with me, and we spent nearly 2 hours talking through the issues I was seeing. This was initiated through the Instagram's High Performance Building Community, which is a remarkable and generous bunch of people, to put it mildly. I did a passable okay job documenting all of this on my Instagram page, @blackcatbuilders. Suffice to say, we did an enormous amount of work on this house to rescue it from structural failure, but we did succeed in the end. We removed the exterior stucco and framed a wall outside the bale, sort of Larson trusses now that I think about it, and filled it with dense packed cellulose. We sheathed it with half-inch CDX and taped the seams, put on an off-the-shelf WRB, and sided it with tulip poplar bark that the clients found on the internet and fell in love with. Years later, the house looks like it's holding up well, though the client sold the place, so I don't have access to keep an eye on it anymore. The project justified me buying a battery-powered chainsaw, which is very cool, and I use it all the time now. Mike's nodding. I nod, too. I think they're amazing. Yeah. I'm including some photos of the project. It was a doozy. I've done a couple larger jobs since, but it was my most expensive repair and remodel at this point in my career. Woo! If you still have Seth's info, feel free to pass along my contact to him if he's still looking for advice. I feel like I need to pay it forward when I recall how much free wisdom folks lent to me. It's 6 months after that episode aired, so he's probably figured it out by now, but who knows. Thanks, as ever, for all your hard work on the podcast and also the magazine, which continues to be great and inspiring. Warmly, Dave. Dave, thank you very much. What do you guys think? That's pretty good advice that we couldn't possibly measure up to.
We know where our limits are, and we may as well just be upfront with it. We have no clue about straw bales.
I know that if we get another question like this, I'm asking Dave first, right?
Yeah, right.
Well, it looks Dave shared a bunch of photos of the project. It looks great.
Yeah.
Yeah, it looks
It looked like a complete mess before. I don't know if you remember this project, but it was the kind of thing where we honestly didn't know what to say because it was really screwed up. And it's, I don't know that there's a lot of experience fixing this new iteration of straw bale homes that have only been around for decades, right? I don't remember learning about them prior to the, I'd say, early 90s.
Have any of you heard of the tulip poplar bark before used as siding? It had an interesting look to it, very coarse, very rustic looking, but I'd never seen anything like it.
You know, when I first saw this bark siding products in general, it was we had gotten some samples at the office at one point, and you know, you looking at the sample, I couldn't imagine that I would like it aesthetically on a house, but this is now like the second or third project I've seen with bark siding, and I like it. I think it, you know, I think it's got a really nice and interesting, unique look.
Well, bark is kind of interesting in itself because you figure that's the way the trees sort of protect themselves. So it's going to be kind of weather resistant and somewhat durable. So it makes sense to put it at you know, on your house.
And otherwise, it becomes mulch, right? It's typically just tossed aside, or maybe, you know, in the best case scenario, it goes into a digester, or it's burned for fuel or whatever. But I think the first time I saw this was at the Solar Decathlon, and I want to say Appalachian State University had this on their project there when I saw it, and that was the first time I. And it might have been something, another species, but it was definitely kind of bark siding, but cool stuff.
Yeah.
Not surprisingly, we also heard from someone who knows more than us on another subject. This comes from Jeremy Hess, who, as y'all may remember, does a lot of fire restoration work for his company. I don't know if they do that exclusively. They might, but he does a lot of this work. Your recent podcast where you discussed finishing an incomplete fireplace piqued my interest. I agree wholeheartedly with the recommendation to have a professional take care of this. With my main line of work being fire restoration, I see all sorts of house fires. And starting in October, we start seeing a lot of fireplace and woodstove related fires. I have two houses I'm putting together now that both had fires caused by fireplaces and woodstoves, but for different reasons. On one project I'm currently wrapping up, the fire was caused by cleaning the chimney. The homeowner had a triple wall pipe running up through the attic space, through the roof, and he was very studious about cleaning it, so studious that his aggressive brushing caused two sections of the chimney pipe to separate. When he started the next fire, the hot gases were venting right into the attic and caught the roof on fire. Thankfully, no one was injured in the fire, but it did result in us completely having to gut the house to remediate the smoke and water damage. The second project, there was no actual fire. There was a traditional brick and masonry fireplace. It looked like the wood framing above the mantle just slowly cooked at an extremely high temperature. The only hint that the owner had that there was a problem was that their rock lath and plaster living room wall was extremely hot to the touch. I've attached some pictures of the damage caused by this fire and how it started. The previous homeowner had installed a wood stove insert into an existing fireplace opening. The insert was too big for the firebox, so we removed the fire brick. When the fireplace and chimney were originally constructed, the clearance to combustibles may have been less than they are now, but there was a small 3/4 by 3 inch channel that went from the backside of the firebox into the wall. So the heat that was coming out of the wood stove was being channeled up into the wall cavity and just slowly cooked the wall from the inside. When I had my trusted wood stove vendor assess the masonry work, he recognized the wood stove and said that there was an adapter to direct the smoke from the wood stove up into the throat of the chimney. He also noted that the throat and damper were not sized or constructed correctly, so whomever installed the insert not only removed the fire brick, they didn't use the proper components to direct the flue gas up the chimney, and because the original firebox and throat were not built properly, it started the fire. During the chimney inspection, we also found evidence of a previous chimney fire where we found burnt creosote. This fireplace was bad news from day one. There are some other aspects of this disaster that I'm forgetting, but this email was long enough. I've attached some pictures to show what we saw. Wow, what do you guys think about that?
There's a lot of risk in fireplaces, you know. And you don't know what either when you're looking at them. Most people don't know what's going to be a good installation or a risky installation, and particularly the older fireplaces, you know, you make a little change, you know, like he's mentioning here, somebody taking out the fire brick. I mean, for clearances, I mean, that, so the difference between like some ordinary brick and some fire brick, it's not just the brick itself, it's also the refractory mortar that they're using. Those are going to be able to handle the temperatures, whereas you take those out and now you've got ordinary mortar and some clay bricks, and those are going to deteriorate quickly and you end up with gaps, and then, wow.
Anyone who's built a fire ring out of old brick or concrete block pieces or whatever knows exactly what Mike's talking about. They are not up to being heated, yeah.
Mm. Yeah, they just explode.
Oh boy, should we get to some questions? Once again, folks, thanks for writing in with your feedback. It's really quite interesting. Steve from New Zealand writes, did you guys hear that? New Zealand? We're huge in New Zealand.
Well, he's not a Kiwi, though. He's a transplant. Yeah. So.
Good day, FHB crew from sunny New Zealand. I'm a big fan of the podcast, and I've been an on-off subscriber to the magazine for a few decades. Well, I'm hoping you'll get back on, Steve. Full disclosure, I'm a structural engineer who has worked on building design since the turn of the century. I much appreciate how much knowledge and experience y'all bring to the table. And I also think you did an excellent job of identifying areas where an engineer or Mike Lombardi are needed to answer a question. As someone who has worked on buildings from the design side of my entire career, I really enjoy listening to you discuss things from a builder's perspective. I've been in New Zealand since July and previously lived in Miami, Syracuse, and Plattsburgh, New York. My wife and I purchased a mid-century home in Hanover, New Hampshire in 2022. It had been abandoned for a few years. I'm overseeing an extensive renovation from far away. The house is a wonderful example of mid-century modern design, and we're going for something of a pretty good gut renovation. Isn't that clever? Pretty good gut renovation. I think we have to add that to the lexicon. It was built in 1953 with acres of single-pane glazing and low-sloped roof. One interesting element of the house was the in-ceiling hydronic heat, something I had never seen before. I wonder why that didn't catch on, right? And hope to never see again. I generally enjoy demo work, but taking out the inch-thick plaster reinforced with metal lath and half-inch copper pipes at 6 inches on center was awful. Have you guys ever had to deal with metal wire lath? It has got to be one of the most evil building materials ever created.
But it's very effective at what it does. It's just when you have to take it apart, that's the problem, right?
Its effectiveness is revealed when you're trying to take it off, as you suggest, yes. My question relates to the exterior wall assembly. The original wall section includes vertical tongue and groove cedar installed directly on 3/4-inch fiberboard sheathing with wood studs. There's horizontal blocking within the stud base to which the cedar siding is face nailed. All of the interior gypsum board and fiberglass insulation has been removed, and the condition of both the fiberboard and exterior siding are shockingly good, likely because the house has generous overhangs on most sides. Boy, that's something we can't say enough, huh? Overhangs really help a house. He says, triple pane clad Marvin windows are being installed as I type this email, or so I'm told. The cedar siding was cut back around the windows to allow the flanges to be installed directly over the fiberboard. Despite some misgivings for environmental reasons, I'm planning to spray the wall cavities with closed cell foam. On the outside, we will remove the cedar siding and replace it with vertical red cedar of a slightly lower grade than what was originally installed. Between the cedar and fiberboard, I intend to use HydroGap dimpled WRB. I would like to get the siding replaced prior to spraying the wall so that the exterior surface of the fiberboard can be viewed before foaming the walls, but the schedule might not allow this. I'm spending a small fortune on the envelope upgrades of this house, and I'm looking for some reassurance that I'm not setting myself up for the issues down the road. Do you agree with spray foam on these walls? I'm also considering dense pack cellulose, but ultimately decided that the foam would provide better R value and would avoid the fussiness of air sealing the existing walls, installing a vapor retarder, etc. I've talked about this with architects and contractors and gotten mostly mixed messages. Any thoughts? Steve. Brian, do you want to go first?
Well, I think I'm afraid that Steve's just going to get some more mixed messages from us.
Yeah.
But, you know, first of all, like to just say it plainly, like there's nothing wrong with what he's planning to do. You know, he's not going to cause any problems, right? I mean, he's going to do some air sealing from the inside with the spray foam. He can also do some more air sealing from the exterior when he installs what, you know, the hydro gap. And, you know, it won't be, you don't want to rely on a mechanically fastened WRB for your air sealing, but it helps. So he's got the potential to do all the air sealing the way he plans on doing it. Using hydro gap is fine. I mean, with siding installations and the whole rain screen question, it's sort of like, you know, it's a good, better, best kind of situation, and a drainable house wrap falls in the little bit better category. And so I don't see any problems with what he wants to do. And he's right that, you know, if he's using closed cell foam, he's going to get the highest R value in the walls that out of all the foams. He's not doing anything to mitigate thermal bridging, which some people would argue you're kind of wasting your money on all that R value if you're not doing anything to mitigate thermal bridging. So why not use cellulose and then use maybe some, do something, whether it's some exterior continuous insulation or I don't know, you could do a Bonfig type of thing on the inside. Like, there are ways to mitigate thermal bridging. And, you know, I don't know what the modeling would show, but I know that there, a lot of people would argue that that's going to yield a better performing wall, one where you've mitigated that, that thermal bridging. You know, so those are some, those are just some sort of quick thoughts. I don't love spray foam either for the environmental reasons. And I don't love spray foam for the reasons that we were just talking about with metal lath, where it's fine. And then someday when you want to remodel, it's not so fine anymore. I've only done a little bit of remodeling on houses that have spray foam, and both times, both were miserable, miserable projects to get back to, you know, to do the demo.
To scrape out the foam, I think is what you're talking about specifically. Yeah.
So those are some thoughts. I mean, I it's not, like I said, I don't have any problems with what he wants to do in terms of the wall. I don't think the wall is going to fail.
What do you think, Mike?
Well, I think that vertical tongue and groove cedar siding is not known to be very water resistant, especially in wind-driven rain. So taking that good, better, best thought that Brian brought up, where you've got a regular house wrap, you got hydro gap, which gives you a drainable house wrap, or putting on a vented rain screen, sort of a, where you put on some furring strips. That's the way I would go with this. But you, if you had different siding, I think the hydro gap's fine. But I think with the vertical TNG, this is your one opportunity, since you're going to take the siding off anyway, to improve the draining and the durability long term, especially with fiberboard back there. That's not known to be very water. Water can deteriorate it pretty quickly. So I would put tar paper and horizontal furring strips, because you're going to go vertical with the TNG, and then let that be your rain screen.
So I just want to say, I think, you know, not only is that, I think that's really smart, Mike, and I wasn't thinking about the fact that it's vertical siding that, that does tend to not be as watertight. So that, I think that's a really good point. I think that I love the fact that you just are suggesting tar paper. Gets to kind of the conversation we were having before we started the podcast about a costs and when we need expensive materials. Also, I would say that once you make that decision and you have to consider, now that you're siding being proud of the house by whatever distance that is, that might push you towards some continuous insulation on the exterior, because if it's causing you to have to do some things like extension jams around your windows, or
he's already installing new windows. You guys are forgetting that. I mean, so now we're going to,
right. He might be already boxed in. He might be boxed to the hydro gap because of that. Yeah.
Assuming Steve can't like reinstall his windows and redo the whole exterior, the sheathing, you know, like, so fiber, wood fiber sheathing, the worst home failures I've read about in my career involve wood fiber sheathing. It was this development that Martin Holliday wrote in, about in Ohio. These brick clad homes, or maybe they were synthetic stone, whatever, had this wood fiber sheathing, and as y'all know, it's super vapor open, so in the summertime these reservoir claddings would drive the moisture right into these wall cavities of these homes, and so badly that water would run out the bottom because of the poly that was on the interior. So it was a sandwich. You could not design something that was worse to collect bulk water from vapor. It's like you made a giant dehumidifier.
That's so, you know, we were just having a conversation about this, Patrick, and that's a good point to mention that, like, you know, I'm glad you mentioned the summertime problem, because moisture accumulation is not just the result of condensation. Really vapor open materials can take on moisture just in high humidity temperatures.
Steve's probably in a more forgiving place in New Hampshire, because he's, you know, it's a predominantly heating climate, so he is not going to have like the solar vapor drive that he might in someplace much warmer. But you know,
so we just wanted some furring strips, but you want him to resheathe his house.
I think Steve is in a position in his construction. If he's having his windows put in now, his options are far fewer. And if you're, you know, I would say leave the siding that's there. Use felt paper in our little folded U-shape assembly that we're talking about. spray foam that and put your some kind of fibrous insulation interior of that and hope for the best. And maybe buy some of those onset hobo data monitors to see how you're doing in there. And it might vary on elevation, right? You might have to make some changes later on certain elevations, but not others. My guess is it's going to be fine. I wish you'd have pulled the fiber sheathing off there, Steve. And, when you were putting the windows in, you were talking about replacing the siding anyway. Why not pull all that stuff apart and spend six figures? Why?
Can you imagine what the so he's in New Zealand and he's having all this work done just monitoring what's going on,
and he's an engineer, lest we forget. Yeah. he probably is not sleeping.
Yeah, so he's yeah. But when you think about the amount of questions that come up that a contractor would want to check with the homeowner on, hey, we just exposed this wall, here's what we're seeing, what do you want to do? So the back and forth, I mean, video conferencing today simplifies it, but still, to be on site and look at it yourself, you can't replicate that over a webcast.
Yeah. I'd love to see some photos, Steve, of the finished project, because mid-century modern is not common in New England, but every once in a while you run into a real gem.
It's a beautiful home, tucked by any measure.
Yeah.
One of the things he pointed out, and it's typical of the mid-century modern, which we've lost, that architects, for some reason, their heads are in the wrong place with today's modern architecture, is overhangs, generous overhangs. You look at a lot of the new modern houses, and it's just a box. It's just the roof and the siding come to a corner, and there's no overhangs. So what happened to that aesthetic and that really principled thoughtfulness of design for your climate with the overhangs? Is that gone forever now?
It makes me think that whatever Steve does with this project, and like you said, we're going to have mixed advice. It's going to be okay because of the overhangs, right? And yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well, they're so helpful. And I think it's a really good point, Mike, to omit, such important details for the sake of style does seem really odd. And I think we become reliant on modern materials. It's sort of the rise in popularity, and it's not a huge rise in popularity, but of like open joint cladding. You're just saying like we can do this. You're essentially saying we don't need siding. We can do all the waterproofing without it, and this is just going to give whatever's back there a little UV protection and give the house a look. So, I actually want to do an article on details for successful open joint cladding, not because I think it's a great idea, but because if people are going to do it, I want to, talk about how to best do it,
That's a short article. Open joint cladding. Don't
do it.
Oh my gosh, I can't wait to get this question. And fortunately, we have a man on location who can talk to this better than anyone else in the Fine Home Building universe. So this comes from Steven. He says, I'm a new listener and only on episode 17. So forgive me if you've covered this already. All I can say, Steven, is you are in for one wild ride if you're only on episode 17. So send us your extra other questions at some point. He says, I'm a 42-year-old truck driver, and I'm only home 4 days a month right now since the account I work for is out of state. I randomly decided to look at rural land for building my retirement home, and I found stop with a roommate model. I discovered Cochise County, Arizona, and they allow you to build with, I think this is right, no site plan review and no inspections, or you can choose to opt in for certain inspections and reviews. Have y'all heard or dealt with this? And I'd like to hear the pluses and minuses of this model. I plan on building a traditional single gable, 2x6 exterior wall home on an ICF crawl space with 2x4 interior walls, approximately 40x36 with a rafter roof. I'd build it in stages as time and money allow. Nothing too fancy. I'm decent with tools and electrical. I also used to drill water wells and I'm planning to drill my own well with an M50 prepper rig. So this takes you down a whole chasm of interesting stuff. So if you folks are unfamiliar with a prepper rig, I'm surprised. No. If you can think back to popular mechanics, every issue advertised one of these little drilling rigs that looks like a lawnmower engine on a metal frame and a hand crank winch. And the premise is you buy one of these for, you know, $1,000 or $1,500 or $2,000, and you can drill your own well at the fraction of a cost of a professional well drilling company. Do you guys remember seeing these wacky things? Yeah. Mm-hmm. So anyway, what do you guys think about? First, Steven's plan to build his own house, which I think is awesome, and I think he's doing it the right way by making it easy. And Cochise County's unique inspection process where you can opt out of inspections, and I'm guessing a plan review based on Steven's email. Mike, you've dug into this. I won't hold you back.
I just looked into it out of my own curiosity, which Steven raised, because I live in the next county over. I'm in Pima County. I'm right on the border of Pima and Cochise, so I'm familiar with Cochise County. It's a pretty rural county, a couple of cities, a few decent-sized towns, but a lot of rural land, so I can see why he was attracted to it. So when you look at their building department website, as a builder, it looks pretty typical. They give you a list of all the things you have to have for a plan review, for your plans to be able to include in your plans for a plan review, and they go through the inspection schedule. But then I dug a little deeper because I didn't understand what Steven was talking about. And there's what they call an owner builder amendment, which encourages people who are in rural areas of the county who are going to build their own home themselves. It allows them to pretty much waive, and it's at the owner's own discretion rather than the building department, waive plan review and waive inspections. And as long as they still have to follow the building code, but they waive all of these other things, and it's an attempt, in part what it explains on the county's website, to reduce the costs of owners who want to build homes or want to utilize alternative building methods and techniques which are not defined in building codes, which, you know, think straw-bale homes, though they've been incorporated into an appendix in the code, are not widely done, but that's an example of something you might do utilizing this. So Steven seems to be right. You can pretty much, as long as you follow the zoning and building codes, you don't get any inspections, and you give them, it says you can, in the county's website, it says you can basically draw your plans on the back of a napkin and submit them.
So, Cochise County, here I come. That's all I can say. What do you guys think about this, Andres, Brian? Are you tempted?
I start to think about what I would build if no one was looking.
It's like, what corners would you
build? Yeah, speaking of corners, I've always wanted to build something with a jack at each corner so that, like, you in no foundation, and you just, like, you put a level.
Level it
levels,
seasonally.
Yeah, build levels into the walls, and just, like, you just crank a little bit or go down
like
a little
RV.
Bit here and there. Yes.
Andres, what do you think of this?
I don't know. I mean, I'm having trouble building a shed in the back of the pyramid. You know, good pyramid. Imagine what I could build.
Yeah.
Well, we do keep hearing stories. I mean, I wish there was a sweet spot. We do keep hearing stories about people who either in larger municipalities where the costs of permitting are just like getting exorbitant, or in places that have just gotten really busy where the permitting process now takes a really long time. And, you know, I think that I believe that the permitting and inspection process is a good thing and a helpful thing, but it also has to, you know, it has to be tenable for the builders and homeowners to, you know, still be able to afford to build, and the builders to be able to keep a schedule. And, you know, and it just seems like more and more in recent years, those stories are creeping up.
I think it's worth pointing out that, you know, zoning has been enacted in places for a good reason. You know, it prevents a poultry farm from moving in next door to you. It prevents your neighbor's effluent from running onto your property. And, you know, these are important things. But I would point out that, as Mike said, you have to follow all the rules, but there is no inspection, which, like, there's a disconnect there for me. So I don't know. And don't you have to have 10 acres, Mike? Did you get to that?
I didn't look that far as to what they considered that. It just said rural parts of the unincorporated county. So there could be an acre limit. But it's easy to buy 10, 20, 100, 200 acres out in that area.
I can tell you that my social media feed and web feeds immediately reflected my interest in Cochise County permitting. That was offered all kinds of weird things, including like house plans, and I was served up a number of YouTube videos of folks who have done this and are explaining the process to others who might be interested. I can tell you I was looking at photos of what looks like a very beautiful part of the country that I've never been. How would you describe the area, Mike?
It's like grassland desert. So as opposed to being like a Sonoran desert where you get a lot of cactus and small trees, out in Cochise, a lot of it that I've been through is like, looks almost like plant the prairie in the middle of mountain areas, in the middle of a mountain area. So it's a lot of little higher elevation and different soils than I have in the area of in Pima County where I am. It's amazing. It's only 15 minutes away, and you'd think on the other side of the mountain range that I'm along, or the mountains that I back up to, it's like you'd think you were in completely two different environments. Yeah. It's beautiful.
It's beautiful. I was very interested about water, and you know, these are difficult things to answer because, you know, the depth of groundwater is very site specific. But I came across a term LSD, and when you do a web search, what that is, you might guess what it comes up with. But it also means land surface datum, which is a general rule of thumb for the level of groundwater, and it's way down there in Cochise County.
And it depends on where you are, because you can be along some of the rivers and you could go down 50 or 100 feet and get all the water you want, or you could be going down 800 feet or more. So it's really going to depend on your elevation and the rock strata underneath.
Well, Stephen, I hope you'll keep us posted on your build, and let us know what you think about your advice. It's going to take you a long time to get to it, though. If you're only on episode 17 of the podcast, it's going to your house is going to be done for a decade by the time you get there.
He's going to fast forward to 626 and just to listen to the answer.
So this comes from Will, and I wanted to read this question because it has everything to do with a feature article idea that Brian had, heat pump water heater questions answered. And I put those words in Brian's mouth regarding what the title is. I hope it'll be better. But I also hope that title that I'm using reflects what we're talking about. So the podcast Fine Home Building, Green Building Advisor are forever getting questions about heat pump water heaters, much like this one from Will. Good evening, gentlemen. Long time listener, first time caller. I live in a 1953 built cape on the South Fork of the Shenandoah River in Luray, Virginia. The house was built by my wife's great uncle from timber off the same land the house is built on. At only 1,100 square feet, the house is beautiful, but it is an absolute energy hog. The house had a cold furnace in the basement and a cook stove in the living room that were both pretty much constantly lit. Air sealing was not an issue in 1953. We now have a carrier heat pump with a dual fuel that has a 92% propane furnace. We use less than 150 gallons of propane a year, which is nice. While there is an absolute ton of work left to do, I am addressing issues one at a time as finances and time allow. We will need a water heater soon. Many of the consumer heat pump units scare me. Hermetically sealed condensing gas units wouldn't be a big deal, but it appears service parts are non-existent and the expected life is short. I stumbled across Steibel Eltron's Accelera heat pump units recently, and I'm intrigued. Have you guys run into these units? Real-world reviews within North America aren't abundant. I'm attaching some pics of the house and property to give perspectives of where we are geographically. Thank you, Will. Will is also in a beautiful part of the country near the Shenandoah National Park, absolutely gorgeous part of the Appalachians. What do you guys think? Have you had any experience with Steibel Eltron's Accelera heat pump, Mike?
Nope. I know the company's water heaters that go along that you connect to a boiler. They've been known throughout the North America. Well, because they're from, I believe, Germany.
Yeah.
But the European do a lot with hydronic heating, so their water heater tanks are known for longevity and durability. I went to their website this morning on the Accelera, and they haven't model it on their software side, I guess, to be different than what we see on most water heaters that we heat pump water heaters we see here. Here we'll see a lot of heat pump water heaters that have selectable modes, like four or five modes. They can go all heat pump. You can go hybrid, where it uses some element and resistance element and some heat pump, or you can go all element for high demand uses. The Steibel Eltron, they sort of have one set.
That sounds like a German engineer came up with that.
And so it might run on electric resistance. They do have an electric resistance element in the top of the unit. So it might end up deferring to that if it feels that your demand needs that extra element boost. But they also tout their extra insulation and efficiency. So, and I wonder if one of Will's concerns was getting parts. And I wonder if you can get parts for those units as well. Because, yeah, parts for water heaters is a problem. I run into that myself.
Brian, thoughts?
Well, I don't know anything about these particular heat pump water heaters. I do know that the company has a good reputation, or as far as I know, the company has a good reputation for making high-quality products. So I think that's well-known and established. I don't know what his – and he also didn't say what his concerns were. He said that the domestic models scare him, but he didn't
say
what.
Well, I think, you know, early ones especially, people complained about the reliability. I know some of the major manufacturers had compressor failures, and, you know, who the heck wants to deal with that?
Yeah, but they've been around for a while now, and I think, you know, we hear very little about problems and failures, and most people that I speak with are pretty happy with their, you know, domestic heat pump water heaters. So don't be scared.
I was going to tell you, Will.
I have a second generation GE, which was, you know, those were like from way back, and mine's 7 years old, and it doesn't show any problems. So I'm curious that if there are problems.
One of my first responses to Will's question was, like, you don't see a lot of Steibel Eltron reviews in the real world because they're. I was expecting them to be way more expensive than other versions, but it turns out they're not. If you check Supply House, the Accela is $3,200. The A.O. Smith is $2,700. Yeah. If you go to the Rheem at Home Depot, it's $2,800. A Rood was also $3,200. So it's right in the ballpark. Yeah. And it has a 10-year warranty. I don't know if the others do, but I think that's worth exploring because compressors are expensive and hard to change. The other thing I was struck by, guys, and we have to keep it brief because we're running out of time, but you know, how much electricity and how many resistance water heaters could you buy for $3,200? And maybe that's an environmentally short-sighted way to view this, but how do you guys respond to that argument?
You'd have to run an energy model to see if the efficiency and the lower energy cost would more than offset the cost of the heat pump water heater when you consider how many of the resistance you could buy for that price and what the lifespan of those would be.
I don't know that anyone's looked at it for a while now, but I mean, at least in our little world here, but we had looked at payback on and although some people argue that's not a good way to look at things, but we had looked at payback a lot on water heating efficiency, water heaters, high efficiency water heaters, and like different methods of distribution, and it was always a hard sell if you're looking at payback, because like Patrick pointed out, because the, you know, the average water heater, average electric resistance water heater is so darn cheap, affordable, so darn affordable, you know.
I think cheap is a good word.
Well, yeah, I mean, I'm not making a statement about the quality of the product as much as I am just the affordability of it. So it makes, you know, and then same thing with distribution systems, right? It gets expensive to install a distribution system that circulates your hot water or whatever it might be. So payback was always a hard thing to make work. Return on investment might work a little bit better. And I don't know, again, maybe some of that's changed, especially now with costs coming down in some of these models and with the rebates that are available. A lot of people are putting in heat pump water heaters these days for the same cost of a decent water heater. You know, not the cheap water heater, but a decent water heater.
I was going to say, if you're going to spend this much on a water heater, you better be prepared to maintain it, right? You're going to want to change the anode. You're going to want to flush it out, because you want to get every year you possibly can out of something this expensive, I would say. I hope you all will write in with your questions about heat pump water heaters. And if you have more advice or better advice for Will, we welcome that too. Any thoughts before we go, gentlemen? Heads ups? Well, this will be after the fact, y'all, but I look forward to seeing you at the JLC Live show coming up. And if I did see you there, great seeing you. Thanks for the conversation, and thanks for writing into the podcast, and thanks very much for listening. Unfortunately, that's all the time we have today. Thanks to Andres, Brian, and Mike for joining me. And most of all, thank you all for very, very much for listening. Please send us your comments, questions, and suggestions, and review us however you're listening. It helps other folks find the podcast. Stay safe, everybody. Keep craft alive. Thanks very much for listening. And if you're that carpenter in New Milford, well, I saw you with the Keep Craft Alive sticker on your truck yesterday, or the Fine Homebuilding Podcast sticker, you know who you are. Rusty Ford Ranger, thanks very much for listening, too.